With the Chinese currency, because as I say, it's now the second most widely used currency in the world. So it's below the US dollar, but it's overtaken the euro. So what exactly has happened in the last year then? Well, I can tell you that last year its share of global trade was just over 1%. Now, if we fast forward, it's reached almost 9%. So what's happened to the euro in contrast then? Well, last year it had almost 8%. Now it's got just over 6%. Now, this is coming at a time when China is changing things up a bit. It's in a state of transition. Now, we know that the state is loosening controls on exchange rates as well as borrowing costs as well. So I wanted to get expert analysis. So I'm going to speak to David Kuo. He's from Motley Fool, and just see. So, David, I want to know, when the euro was first introduced, it was supposed to rival the US dollar as the global reserve. We've now got the yuan overtaking the euro. So do you think that that dream is well and truly dead?
What a wonderful question. I think as far as the euro is concerned, I mean, the euro has probably shot itself in the foot because the countries within the eurozone, when they are dealing in international trade, they perhaps, you know, weren't as strong in deciding that the rest of the world should use the euro as the base currency. In other words, when they wanted to buy goods from China, they were quite happy to actually buy goods based in US dollars. So really, I think the eurozone hasn't been as forceful as they could have been. Had they done so, then maybe, you know, the euro would have been more freely traded. But at the moment, I mean, the euro is still quite freely traded in comparison, say, to the yuan, which is not as freely traded, because there are still some countries in the world that might say, if I want to do business with China, I would much rather deal with them using either the US dollar or some other kind of currency. So in answer to your question, what is going to happen to the euro, that really depends on what the eurozone decides itself. Does it want to be more forceful or not?
And David, we know the whole reason we discuss money is because it's all about power, isn't it? And what does this transition mean in terms of power for China? Because we know they are in a transition period at the moment as an economy.
That is a wonderful question, and this is really the crux of the matter, because at the moment China is sitting on around $3.5 trillion US dollars worth of foreign reserves. Now China doesn't really want to increase that amount of foreign reserves, which is why it is trying to make the yuan more tradable. In other words, when you buy goods from China, China is saying we're going to denominate that in Chinese yuan, so that we don't have to sort of keep on taking in all these foreign reserves. Now eventually China, as you quite rightly say, is going to move from being export-led to becoming more consumer-led. In other words, it will have to spend some of those foreign reserves in order to buy foreign goods. But I suspect, you know, China really doesn't want to run down its foreign reserves too much, but it would much prefer to use the Chinese yuan, which it can control itself. It can print as much Chinese yuan as it wants to. So if it wants to start buying goods, you know, from the outside world, it may decide, you know, that it wants to use the Chinese yuan to buy that. But in order to do that, the Chinese yuan has to be more freely traded. And this is really the first step. I mean, we're seeing now that the Chinese yuan has overtaken the euro in terms of trade finance. The next step will, of course, you know, be the Chinese yuan being more freely traded around the world. And that is also happening because, I mean, we have all these deals now between the People's Bank of China and the Bank of England and the European Central Bank and, of course, many banks out here in Southeast Asia.
Yeah, times are changing there. David Kuo there, thank you ever so much for talking to us.